We are at a crossroads in this nation.
Children, what's that sound? Everybody look what's going down.
If we are going to weather this existential crisis that we face in this country,
we're not in Mexico.
We must unite. When we dig deep to see beyond ourselves and we see others for who they are as human beings, our power has no limits.
It's hard sometimes to be away. Tengo familia esparcida por todas partes. ¿Dónde estás ahorita? My parents live in Mexico and cannot travel anymore. They're older now. Háblale a la abuela, enséñale. It's important for me to feel like I'm there and they can see my children grow. ¿Qué le acaba de ganar una competencia de baile? Despite the distance, we can communicate easily and share special moments.
There for you when it matters most. Unlimited on the best network now always includes Apple Music on us, starting at only $40, only on Verizon.
All across the country, people are coming together to speed up what we can learn about health. The All of Us Research Program is calling on 1 million people to join us as we try to change the future of health. For your family, for future generations, for all of us. Visit joinallofus.org and find out how you can become one in a million.
Welcome back. Wherever you are today, we're so happy that you are together with us because LULAC is here serving you. That's really what we're about because, you see, when something impacts a member of our community, it impacts all of us. And this is why I'm here with you today, and I'm so happy that you've made time to join me. Look, coming up, one of the most important topics that always, always is right here, front and center, en la conciencia y también cómo se siente la familia, the way families feel today about immigration. That is a topic that's coming up right now. But before we get into that discussion about immigration and the law, we want to turn to a dear friend of LULAC who is down in the state of El Paso, or the state of Texas in El Paso, Veronica Escobar, and she's going to have these words for you as well. Veronica.
Hi, I'm Veronica Escobar, Congresswoman for El Paso, Texas, the 16th Congressional District, and I'm coming to you from my community on the safe and secure U.S.-Mexico border. Welcome to LULAC's 2020 All for One and One for All Summit. Thank you so much to LULAC for hosting this important conversation, and thanks to each and every one of you for participating in it. Your voices are more important than ever. Since 1929, LULAC has been a leading voice for Hispanics in this country on civil rights issues and indeed on immigration and immigration reform. We have seen over the last 3 years immigration come to the forefront in a way that has exposed a racial divide in this country. It has exposed the possibilities of inhumanity aimed at immigrants, and it has brought to the forefront the need to prioritize comprehensive immigration reform once and for all. We've seen immigrants not just demonized and targeted, but they, like so many of us Latinos in the country, have been disproportionately impacted by COVID-19. During this pandemic, in California, in fact, the Department of Homeland Security has acknowledged that immigrants are key essential workers, key to our communities, key to the ability for us to eat the food that is on our table and to be served and provided with that food that is on our table. And yet, so many of these immigrants are vulnerable to deportation. We have to acknowledge that now is the time for us to finally take action. And this year, 2020, this very important election year, we have to make sure that this topic is at the top of the priority list. Among so many other priorities, we have to fight to make sure that our voices are heard and that this issue doesn't get punted or pushed down on the priority list as it has been before. Thank you all once again for being such an important voice. Thank you for being together on this journey as we try to create a more just and humane world for all of us, including immigrants. Good luck and best wishes on your conversation.
Our sincere thanks to Representative Escobar for those kind words. We love you down in El Paso, and we remember your community, and you are with us always. Muchas gracias. Our dear leader, Ray Mancera, down there in the state of Texas. My name is David Cruz, and it's now my honor to bring you our next conversation, a conversation that probably more than any other subject in my many years of covering the Latino community always comes to the fore. It is immigration. You know, maybe you've been watching on one of the networks, I think it's Netflix, doing Immigration Nation, and you see these horrible stories of how ICE is sweeping down on people and breaking up families. And we've heard, of course, earlier today, what goes on at the border. So all of these are the pesadillas. They are the nightmares in our community. And this is why I'm so happy to have and be able to introduce to you Charles Kamansky. He is the Senior Cabinet Advisor for Unidos US. And I want to tell you, Charles is an expert, renowned expert on immigration. Also, he is an author. And with him today, we bring back President Domingo Garcia and a distinguished panel. So I'm going to turn it over to Charles. We welcome you y gracias for what you do.
Thank you so much for that kind introduction. Our panel today is about LULAC's historic role in immigration reform. And I'm so pleased to have this opportunity to join the nation's oldest and largest Hispanic organization to talk about its historic role in shaping the nation's immigration policy and to look forward to talk about what we might do as a community to achieve a more just and humane immigration system. One of the things I wanted to do was to set the stage. And I'm lucky enough to have this opportunity because I have written a book called Immigration Reform, The Corpse That Will Not Die, that talks about the 1986 to 1990 period in particular, which was the last time the nation actually enacted comprehensive immigration reform. And it's important to understand that that's really an extraordinarily historic time. And to place these reforms in historical context, I'm going to first ask the audience to zoom out, to look at that period of immigration reform in a much broader period. So I would start by saying that the seeds of the Immigration Reform and Control Act of 1986 and its follow-on bill, the Immigration Act of 1990, were actually first planted in 1972 when the House of Representatives first passed what later became IRCA. And until 1981, you had that the House of Representatives acting, but the Senate not acting. Kind of similar in reverse to what we've been experiencing in recent years. The second phase I wanted to talk about from say 1981 to 1984 included the early debate on the Immigration Reform and Control Act, which we call IRCA. And it's important to reflect on what that bill actually did as introduced and what it did as it actually passed. As introduced, this was a very restrictionist bill. Its major provisions included expanded border enforcement, so-called employer sanctions, which were for the first time made it unlawful to knowingly hire an undocumented worker, a hard cap on legal immigration that would have cut legal immigration by about a third, major cutbacks in asylum protections, increases in temporary agricultural worker programs, and a very limited legalization program that might have legalized perhaps a million people. I characterize these bills that twice passed the Senate by 60 vote margins and passed the House by, in somewhat modified form in 1984, by a 5-vote margin, as really highly restrictionist bills. But then, as they actually were enacted, IRCA and the follow-on bill, the 1990 Act, while they did retain their predecessors' enforcement provisions, this is what the bills actually included. Rather than legalize 1 million people, they ultimately legalized more than 3 million people. Instead of cutting legal immigration, they nearly doubled it from its 1980s levels. Instead of an agricultural guest worker program, it included an agricultural legalization program. The bills did not cut asylum protection significantly, but did create temporary protected status that resulted in covering some 800,000 Central Americans being protected from deportation. And the 1990 Act, in addition to doubling legal immigration, codified a stay of deportation for perhaps a million immediate family members of newly legalized people under so-called family unity protections. So if you take these reforms collectively as a whole, I would argue they should be characterized not as just center-left, as they were in that period, but really fundamentally progressive in direction and character. Having zoomed out to look at this longer period of history, I'm going to ask you to now zoom in to a very specific period that led to the enactment, ultimately, of the 1986 Reform Bill. As detailed in my book, Immigration Reform, The Corpse That Will Not Die, these included many key steps led in whole or in part by LULAC. What are some of those examples? One of them was a so-called filibuster by amendment. So right out of the starting gate in 1982, after the Senate had passed the first version of IRCA by an 80 to 19 vote, the bill died on the House floor. The reason was the use of a highly unconventional tactic, what the New York Times and the Washington Post called the outrageous tactic, led by the Hispanic Caucus and advocates, who drafted and filed 200 amendments and, quote, threatened to demand a roll call vote on each one. LULAC staffers and volunteers were among those who led the effort to draft dozens of these amendments that helped kill this bill. The second example I would give is delays. In 1983, the following year, after the Senate again passed the bill by a huge margin, House Speaker Tip O'Neill twice refused to schedule it for floor action. O'Neill finally relented in 1984, but delayed floor action again, pushing the beginning of the House-Senate Conference Committee from when it would otherwise have taken place in June into September of that election year. And LULAC played the key role in convincing Speaker O'Neill to pull the bill from the schedule. The third example I would give is high politics. So given that reprieve from June until September, what took place over that summer was the Democratic National Convention. And LULAC there led a first ballot boycott of Latino delegates pledged to frontrunner presidential candidate Walter Mondale because of his failure to oppose the legislation significantly enough. Again, that led Mondale to declare his opposition to that legislation just as it was going into a House Senate conference committee, and that bill died ultimately in conference committee. Finally, I would note there was then a pivot towards compromise. So the very next year in 1985, just as it appeared we were being successful, the coalition that LULAC, NCLR, the ACLU, AILA, the American Immigration Lawyers Association, Church World Service, and the National Immigration Forum, just as our coalition appeared to have been being successful in stopping the bill, we pivoted towards compromise. Led by a second term Congressman Esteban Torres, who broke with his elders in the Hispanic caucus, most of whom were diehard opponents, we engaged in a series of back channel negotiations with the bill sponsors that I believe ultimately moved the legislation in a much more progressive direction. And having LULAC's imprimatur was essential to facilitating this strategic shift, which ultimately, as I described, produced a much more progressive bill. So as we turn to the panel, and as we look to the future of, I think it's fair to say, and I think the LULAC membership should be very proud of the role of its legacy in having shaped the last round of immigration reforms. So I'd like to start the discussion first with a question for President Rosales and others on the panel. And I think it's safe to say that prior to the 1980s, LULAC was widely viewed among scholars and activists as a relatively conservative organization on immigration. It soon became seen as the champion for Hispanic immigrants. And I'd like to ask, what changed and why? And perhaps we can start with you, President Rosales.
Actually, it wasn't really what changed, in my opinion. The fact of the matter is that LULAC did not have a national presence, you might say, with the national media, because LULAC, you know, forever has been out, you know, fighting for the immigrantes from marches and everything from the very beginning. And they started the local to the state to the national. But we didn't have that national independence that LULAC now has. What we learned from that, so I would say that's most important, that what we learned from that, what it changed. What's changed that we realized the power of having a national presence. National presence and to be able, now they say it was unorthodox, you know, whatever. But I think the methods that were used, not so much that LULAC used all this kind of tactics. It was a matter of giving support to Congressman Torres, that LULAC, with the full backing of LULAC, gave the support, and that made a difference. Because LULAC, you remember that it was those the state of Iowa, LULAC, that had and brought out the facts. And that was so important because it gives to me what changed. We got national attention, which did not take away from all the actions that LULACers nationwide, as individual councils, at state level and the national level. But we didn't have that independence national media with us. We didn't have that kind of coverage that LULAC has always been there in the struggles. So I don't think that we were conservative in immigration, is that we didn't get the attention of all the action items that individual councils do along with the state. And there, one of the things we need to make sure that people understand, that we're volunteers, and as volunteers, you know, we take actions as long as we abide by the state and then the national board, the national constitution and resolutions, and the state also, you know, LULAC locals do a lot of so at the state level. I remember once that I burned the Contract for America as a state director in LULAC. You know, we took a match, got a can, and we burned and had a press conference. You know, so I think that the activism of LULAC has always been there. Now, and we realized the importance of getting national attention and developing that independence we could do it as go support progressive issues.
I'm so glad you raised the example of working with your Iowa state chapter. One of the incidents I describe in my book is after then Representative Tom Harkin, his wife was revealed in the press as being the chief lobbyist for growers seeking a new Bracero program. and LULAC's state chapter in Iowa, right? Which, and at that time, the Latino population in that state was tiny, led an effort to protest the fact that Senator Harkin was involved in an effort, or later Senator Harkin, then Congressman Harkin, was involved in an effort to impose a new bracero program. And I think ultimately that made a big difference in the bill. President Garcia, you were in law school, I guess, in the early years of the debate over the Immigration Reform and Control Act. How closely did you follow the debate? And you know, to what extent were you aware of LULAC's role, and how has that shaped your thinking in about your presidency?
Well, you know, I'm going to bring it up. I was interested that you had this conversation, because I was talking to Federico Peña yesterday after the Kamala Harris decision. He was a former mayor of Denver. I went to the 1984 Democratic National Convention as a Jesse Jackson delegate. Okay. And I was at the Hispanic Caucus on the date that I made a motion that all Latinos should abstain from voting on the first ballot unless the Democratic Party supported amnesty for 3 million immigrants at that time. And Henry Cisneros, who was the mayor of San Antonio at the time, was chairing the caucus. And I remember I made the motion, it was seconded, and Henry made an eloquent speech about why we should not abstain. And we voted 2/3 to abstain. As a result, I got a phone call the next morning, and me and Juan Maldonado, Rosa, you might know who he is, he was a former mayor of San Juan, Texas, were called in to a meeting with Walter Mondale, Geraldine Ferraro, Henry Cisneros, Federico Peña, Tip O'Neill. And I remember at the meeting, Tip, they tried to tell us and reason with us, and we were young, kind of like the people marching right now. We were wild radicals from the Raza Unida Party back age 25. And they tried to tell us we needed to stop the abstention movement, that immigration would come, we just gotta let the system work. I said, that ain't gonna be enough. And I remember Tip O'Neill, he had a cigar in his mouth, and he looked at me and he goes, Mr. Garcia, are you telling us that if we support, if I put legislation to pass an amnesty bill, that you will withdraw and release your delegates? I said, yeah. And he did. Okay. He made that promise. We shook hands on it. And it didn't happen until 1986 when the immigration bill did pass. And he called me. And I, you know, like I said, I'm 27 years old, fresh out of law school. And he just said, Mr. Garcia, I just want to thank you. I hope you're happy. And, you know, Ronald Reagan signed that bill. Can you imagine a Republican signing an immigration bill today? You know, and that's the impetus of that moment in time. And I was a LULAC member, you know, brand new, but fighting because my parents were immigrants. So it was personal. My father came across as an undocumented immigrant from Coahuila. My mother was from Chihuahua. So I knew that struggle. I knew what other people in my neighborhood were facing. And I had family. We were in a mixed family where some were undocumented, some were citizens. I was a U.S. citizen. I was born in Texas. And so that's always been very something that we've been keeping on. I think that's something that LULAC's tradition of fighting for every immigrant into this country and, you know, really living up, making America live up to what's etched on the Statue of Liberty, and that America stands as a nation of immigrants and stands for equal opportunity for all. And we continue to do that, whether it's Rosa was, I think, was with me when, you know, we stopped an immigration bus full of kids last year in McAllen, Texas, a couple of years ago, actually now. And the fact that we have, you know, baby jails right now with immigrant children here in 2020. The fact that LULAC had just had a protest at a hotel in Harlingen, Texas last week, where kids were being put into hotel rooms, not being allowed access to attorneys, not being allowed access to a hearing. I mean, these are just things that are beyond the pale. Immigration agents in Portland, Oregon, with no uniform, no identification, snatching people off the streets and putting them in unmarked vans. I mean, and immigration is being used in that manner. But it really is time to defund ICE, in my opinion. I think they're out of control. But this starts, again, back from the 80s till today. And I think whether it's President Biden or President Trump's reelected, we need to make sure that we put the pressure on so that we have an immigration reform bill within the first 100 days. Because if it doesn't happen within the first 100 days, it's just going to continue to be pushed down the road like it's been doing for the last 20 years, Charles. As you know, you've seen how politicians just look at immigration as the third rail of politics.
Indeed. Cindy, you're far too young to have been directly engaged in some of the debates we're discussing here, but does knowing some of this history shape your legislative strategy going forward? And if so, in what ways?
First and foremost, Charles, it's such an honor to be joining you on this panel. You are just a wonderful advocate that has been doing this work for so long. I have your book and thank you for signing it for me. And it is truly an honor to also be on this panel with President Rosales, who is my hero. And I know the hero of so many individuals tuning in and someone that has been extremely supportive of me in this role, and President Garcia, who is bold in his leadership and is not afraid to really make sure that we keep the pressure on and that we remind everyone that who LULAC stands for is for our community. And I will tell you, Charles, and this is something actually that you may not be aware of, but I'm a direct beneficiary of IRCA. My father actually benefited from IRCA in 1986. And then that was able to, he was able, when he became a legally present in the U.S., Charles, to then be able to sponsor his family so that we all could be legally in the country, having been brought undocumented. And so I am very grateful to the role that you have played, the role that individuals like John Trasviña, the role that LULAC members have played behind the scenes. And you know, what folks don't know is that LULAC is an action-oriented organization. And I believe that President Rosales put it best. A lot of the work that happens across this country and LULAC is through our LULAC councils. And these are volunteer members who have jobs that they do during the day, and then they're superheroes in the weekends and at night or in their spare hours, helping to transform America. And, you know, for a long time, LULAC did not have a national office. In fact, it didn't happen until the late 80s. And I will also tell you, Charles, that something that we fail at miserably is communicating all the great work that we do. And so I do feel that President Rosales hit it on the dot and that we've always been doing this work. We've just had a massive failure in communicating. And we're so thankful that you actually wrote this book and included LULAC, because so many individuals do not know the role that LULAC has played in immigration reform, and that, you know, perhaps we were not the ones in front of the media, but we certainly were the ones making those calls. We certainly were the folks calling for a boycott. We certainly were the folks having those really tough conversations with members of Congress. We certainly were the folks that were calling them out. And, you know, for us, it's the legacy that LULAC carries. We're not a conventional or traditional organization. We've never been that. We've always been a grassroots organization that is proud of the legacy that we have because of the leaders, our LULAC members who do this work every day. And as we look at immigration reform, Charles, first, I have to acknowledge that in my own contact, as I am leading LULAC as CEO, and what I have observed since the early 2000s, you know, really after 9/11, when we start seeing a lot of enforcement focused immigration issues, is one, you know, I can't but be reminded of the Sensenbrenner bill. I can't but be reminded of the McCain-Kennedy bill and the failure of not being able to pass the McCain-Kennedy bill. I think, you know, for us, it's of great dismay. We also know that President Obama had it under his charge in the first year to be able to pass immigration reform. But unfortunately, the Affordable Care Act took 3 years to pass, right? And so I think it's also a call to action for our community, for our advocates, for our leadership to keep the pressure on Congress. And as President Garcia mentioned, to make sure that whoever the next president is that is sitting at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, that they understand that this is an absolute priority for our community, that we want to see something in the first 100 days pass. And we want to see a plan of action that's inclusive. I also have to acknowledge, Charles, that, you know, in this realm that we work in as advocates, as a nonprofit leader, that oftentimes the Latino organizations are being left out of the conversation. And as Latinos, and we know that obviously immigration is an American issue, that it impacts various groups from across the globe, but that Latino organizations are being left out is really worrisome. And even there, I know that through the leadership of President Garcia, individuals like Lydia, individuals like Tom at MALDEF and others, we have now a small working group of Latino-led organizations, including Unidos, Clarissa representing Unidos, to make sure that we look at immigration reform from a Latino lens, and that it's Latino organizations that are leading this fight in 2020 and making sure that whatever bills are proposed in the future, that it includes our voice and our narrative. And I think what we're seeing now, Charles, is that there's a piecemeal solution. We understand the context that we're living in under this current precedent, where, you know, fighting for DACA, something that is a no-brainer, that is as logical as American pie, is not happening, right? And clearly we have our work cut out for the next few months to make sure that we continue that pressure on. But I think as we look at the future, it's obviously continuing to build those alliances, those partnerships, pushing on multiple fronts, having those backroom conversations, helping draft the bills where we can draft them, and making sure, obviously, that as an organization, again, LULAC being unconventional, non-traditional, always with the community at mind, that we use every single tactic to pressure our members of Congress and make them understand that they can be held accountable.
Thank you for that, Cindy, and thank you for those kind words. I would say I think maybe you're being a little bit modest about LULAC's role. I think beginning with Rubén Bonilla, followed by Tony Bonilla, and then the late Mario Obledo, Oscar Moran, all of whom were presidents during that important period. I think it's fair to say LULAC was very much front and center in the press during those debates. Rosa, you were also front and center during the debate in the mid-2000s, around the time the Sensenbrenner bill passed, the mass marches all over the country. Then a Kennedy-McCain bill did pass the Senate, and, you know, just could never get passed in the House. What are your reflections, having led LULAC during that very formative period of immigration reform?
I remember that during that time, LULAC has became part of very progressive organizations. And the reason that we were not for the bill as it was, because of all, it wasn't a comprehensive bill to begin with. And there were too many things in there. The progressive organizations, along with LULAC, as part of a coalition, we went against it. And I do remember that some organizations were very upset with us and, made it seem that LULAC stopped everything. But we were part of progressive organizations that we felt that that bill included too many bad things in there that were not good for the immigrants. And that's one of the reasons I remember. And that, you know, if we're going to, there's nothing wrong with going out there and pushing for what you believe in. As long as we keep our eye on the apple, as long as we don't sell the store to get just any bill in, we have to be, you know, I'm for negotiating, I'm for meeting, all that. That's taken very well. But we must never forget that we have to pass something that takes in that immigrants are human beings and need to be treated as human beings. What is happening right now in this country is something that you see what's happening and you want to cry. I've never in my life, and I know that we went through the 1930s and the 1954 Operation Wetback, you know, where they took citizens as well as immigrants and took them all the way into Mexico, and many of them never came back because, as citizens that they were. They came in with their rifles. We have some horrific stories of how immigrants have been treated, Latinos and all immigrants. So LULAC, you know, like Cindy said, and President Garcia, we're grassroots, you know, and we're volunteers. So I always say, you know, you have to have, like I say in LULAC, mucho corazón. And that's what LULAC members have. You have to have the love for our communities, the love for them to be treated with respect and dignity and in a fair and just manner, and as human beings. This is a humanistic issue. That's what it is.
Indeed. And I think the bill you're specifically referring to that you opposed was a bill that was passed in 2006 in the Senate. I think you're referring to the 2007 bill that never made it out of the Senate that LULAC did not support. President Garcia, you were you actually have the distinction of, as a legislator, actually having passed an immigration bill, if I'm not mistaken. You were the chief sponsor of the Texas Dream Act, the Texas in-state tuition law that would have been, in the 1990s. What lessons did you learn from that battle that we might apply to the current reform debate?
Well, you know, that started with a simple, I had the valedictorian of Pinkston High School, who was, when her dream was to serve our country and to go to West Point. And the Congressman Frost appointed her to go to West Point. She got to West Point, tried to register, and they asked her for a birth certificate. She called her mom, and her mom told her a family secret. She was undocumented. And because she was undocumented, Maria could not get into West Point and was sent back home. And then she applied to Texas A&M, which accepted her, but she had to pay out-of-state tuition, which is three times the normal rate. Her family was working class. And so because of her case, I filed House Bill 1403, which said that if you graduate from a Texas high school, you pay in-state tuition. And another state rep, Rick Noriega from Houston, also had a similar case, another valedictorian who had to pay out-of-state tuition because of her situation. And so we co-authored that bill. It was the first bill that passed, by the way, with six Republicans and six Democrats, passed the Texas Senate 27-3, and was signed by Governor Rick Perry, a Republican. It was not controversial. I also passed a bill that allowed driver's license for all immigrants, passed the House, passed the Senate, but that was vetoed by Rick Perry. But that bill became the nexus of the Dreamers, because I went to California to speak at UCLA. There was a state senator named Gil Cedillo there who liked the bill that we had passed in Texas, and he passed it in California. And now 19 states, I believe at last count, have in-state tuition bills. And that's where all these Dreamers come from. And one of the reasons that I'm president of LULAC right now is I want to get them to the finish line. That bill passed in 2001. Here we are in 2020, and all the protection they have, many of them, is DACA. Many of them don't even have that. Trump, even though the Supreme Court ruled DACA could not be invalidated the way it was done, is not taking new applications for DACA. So you still have a lot of these children, students now, who are in limbo. And we need to make sure that we get them across the finish line, and LULAC finishes the job that we started in 2001 when we passed the in-state tuition bill, the Texas Dream Act, and that we passed the Dream Act for all Dreamers, but really for all the 12 or 13 million immigrants in this country. No matter what Trump says, you can't deport 13 million people. And if you do, you're not going to have steaks or pork chops or chicken on your table. You're not going to have vegetables, because that's who does all that work. It's campesinos. You're not going to be able to have your construction of your new home done, because there ain't going to be anybody there to do that construction work, and so on. So, Latinos are essential workers. We're not disposable workers. And immigrants are the lifeblood of America. And it's important that we recognize that, and that Congress passes a comprehensive immigration reform bill that allows them a pathway to legalization and citizenship.
Indeed. I mean, I'm struck by your comment that it was a bipartisan bill in a Texas legislature that, even now more than in those days, but in those days was viewed as a quite conservative legislature. I remember my colleague, Clarissa Martinez, who Cindy mentioned, was in Texas at the time and worked on that bill. So how did you work with your Republican colleagues to bring them along?
I found three Republicans who actually were all from Dallas. One was a Latina Republican, rare, but still a Latina Republican, and Fred Hill, who was a Republican who represented a diverse district that had 13 languages in a suburban Richardson, Texas. And you should have been there. And I hope that one day we get that video. When we brought up all these students who said, I was valedictorian, salutatorian in my class, and now I'm cleaning houses. Now I'm working as a gardener because I can't get into a college. I can't get any help with my tuition payments. And these were heartbreaking stories. You know, Latinos and Latinas from the Valley, from Houston, from Dallas, all over, they came and gave testimony, and half the panel of state representatives, Republicans and Democrats, were in tears about the injustice of it. And that allowed us to push it forward. And like I said, at that time, the Democrats controlled the House, the Republicans controlled the Senate and the governorship. But because it was three Republicans, three Democrats, they were co-sponsors of the bill, it passed. And it was not controversial at the time. Rick Perry regretted it later when he ran for president, and Mitt Romney attacked him for signing the in-state tuition bill. And Rick Perry said, you know, you don't have a heart. But it kind of killed his presidential bid back whenever he ran. I forgot when that was.
Indeed. I think, yes, we all remember that period. Cindy, and I think it's important to remember for many in the audience, you know, LULAC has a quite a significant membership that includes longtime Republicans, a lot of small business owners, and others. What are your thoughts about mobilizing LULAC members who are Republican, and have you tried that, and what are your plans for doing that in the future?
Thank you for that question, Charles. And you know, what makes LULAC so unique is that we represent the community in all its political spectrums. We have members who are Democrats, who are independent, who are Republican, some who don't even identify with none of the political parties. And you know, what we have seen with our membership is that we certainly rally around the different issues that are important, the way that we're structured. And you know, at LULAC, we actually have something that's our constitution, and it's about 91 years in history making. It's what guides us and what has guided this organization for over nine decades. And in this constitution, it really outlines, one, the autonomy of the councils, but also it establishes our platform at a national level, which the entire assembly votes on. And we're very fortunate that a majority can vote on a policy platform that supports certain issues. And certainly immigration reform and different aspects of immigration reform have come before the full body to be voted on. You know, we understand to Charles that immigration is only one issue that impacts Latinos. And it, you know, when we look at the economy, it's another issue that impacts us, education and equity in education, health. And so we really do try to look at what are really the compromises and what are those points that we can rally around and support as an organization at the national level. And we are also very fortunate that we have members from all political stripes, because we have these internal discussions. And you know, for members who have had who have attended our national board meetings, you know that in those board meetings, it can get interesting, and that as advocates, you know, we have our beliefs and we will talk about the issue from whatever political spectrum, from whatever experience we see, or, you know, from a state perspective even. And I can tell you that immigration reform varies in how it's viewed even across states. And, you know, like if you're talking about a state that has a high farm working community, there's a huge emphasis on agriculture and ag jobs and making sure that workers in this specific field are protected. You know, we also have key states like California and Texas where you have a massive Dreamer DACA community. And so we also see one, the different issues within immigration reform surface. And I would say, Charles, also that what makes us so unique, again, is that we have all these perspectives and we can have these conversations internally and really debate them internally. And it makes us even better advocates as we walk the hallways in Congress. It makes us better advocates in understanding how our Republican LULAC members view this issue and what are some themes or information and facts that we can pull as we advocate for this issue. We also know that within LULAC, you have members who are immigrants. And you have members who have been here for more than five generations. So we do really have a little bit of everything. And I would just add, Charles, because I think this is really important, that something that I'm seeing as we move forward is this focus on how we, as Latinos, how we actually create the narrative about immigration. And I think this is very important, just given the context, the political climate where we have been living, where, you know, the current president coming in started his campaign by calling Mexicans all types of words that I'm not going to repeat because it just gives credit to what he says. You know, we're living in a current political structure where our immigrant community is continuously attacked. And I think in this way, we have so much work ahead of us to make sure that we recreate the narrative of who immigrants are in America, what immigrants have contributed, and also even during this pandemic, Charles, this president attacks our immigrant community, the essential workers in America who are keeping the American economy going. And it's just such a juxtaposition in terms of, you know, what we see from a standing Republican president to, you know, what we see or the failure and silence of Republicans in Congress to what we see with Democrats and also Democrats, some of them who are in very conservative states who are not taking harder positions on this issue. And I just, you know, I can't but also bring this up because I know President Garcia and President Rosales brought it up, but it is unconscionable that in 2020, we have children in cages. And I can't but be reminded of an image that will forever stand out in my mind as President Garcia entered his administration under LULAC, where he was at a border city and literally stopped a bus full of children who were as young as 2 years of age. And if you can just imagine these little hands, Charles, on the window of a bus and us trying to tell them how much they are loved, how much we are fighting for them. We know we have a massive fight ahead. We will be campaigning and continue to campaign for our children so that they're treated as human beings. But we have a massive task in terms of creating the narrative of immigrants being human beings and starting at that basic level to shift the heart of America on this particular issue.
Indeed. And, you know, I think we're all touched by that image that's, you know, so embedded in our minds of kids in cages. I think we also, you know, have to think about the images we don't see, which are the kids in families now that don't have access to broadband and, you know, are losing their educations. Their family members aren't eligible for so much of the safety net. And therefore, these kids are really being cut out from support. President Rosales, I think one of the things that was fascinating out of President Garcia's description of how the Texas Dream Act happened was the use of personalized individuals to tell their stories. You know, can you reflect on your tenure and not just when you were president, but really your very long tenure with LULAC and tell us the kinds of things we ought to be looking at and the next generation ought to be looking at going forward to try and ensure people are telling their own stories.
I would say, in my experience and what I see where the organization go, the LULAC has to continue to address the issues. That is what brings in our people. When we start addressing the issues at the grassroots level and bringing out the facts and the importance of dealing with Congress and with the Senate, the importance, and we do have the visits to the White House, you know, those are very important to begin to let the facts come out. I think, and then of course, nothing is more important, like President Garcia said, the testimony of what they're going through. Testimony from the DACA students, testimony from those that are out of a job, testimony what is happening right now in this country. But LULAC will continue to grow because LULAC is a grassroots organization and it's volunteers that we are. A lot of people think we're a service organization. We're actually an advocacy. We advocate for the Latino communities. And that gives us a lot of importance to me. because you have to address the issues. You have to be loud and clear. Like I go back to Iowa. What is it they did? They had press release. They brought up the facts. What was happening? That's so important that the public knows. There's a lot of people, there's a lot of misinformation. And I think LULAC's role is to bring out the facts. You know, have those gathering, have those marshes. Right now it's kind of dangerous, but, you know, continue to go ahead and have the marches that we used to have, continue to address the issues, be there visible and telling the people, we are with you. We are with you and we will fight for you. The fight continues to go, but the issues continue, we need to address. And that's so important because once you address the issues, when you address the issues, that's what motivates people. Oh, I didn't know that. Oh, yes, this is what's happening. And let me go, this is the fictions against the lies that have been said, and this is the truth. What the immigrantes contribute to this country, and this is a country of immigrants. And that's what it's important that we continue our conversations and bringing out the facts to the congressmen, to the Senate, and making sure that they address the Latino agenda. And making sure, I've always said, I like to see them shaking the boots when they know that they did not listen to us, and we're gonna get out that vote and make sure that it's only those congressmen and senators that support the LULAC agenda, which is a humanistic grassroots agenda.
Indeed, and I think we're getting the high sign that we need to begin wrapping this panel up. So again, I wanna thank you for this opportunity to join you at your virtual national summit. And I would just say to the LULAC members in attendance and everyone else, I was remarking to Cindy before the panel that, you know, I've seen you guys doing a town hall almost every week. I've seen Domingo flying around the country visiting meatpacking plants and demanding protections for essential workers. And that, you know, we have big challenges going forward as a community, but I would also say LULAC members should be very proud of the leadership they have and be very confident in their leadership that you'll be able to represent a Latino voice in the immigration debates going forward. So again, thank you to the panelists, President Garcia, President Rosales, Executive Director Cindy Benavides, and everyone for joining us. It's been a real pleasure for me. Thank you.
Thank you,
Charles. Y que viva LULAC.
Thank you, Charles. All for one and one for all.
Indeed.